Subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon to get instant updates for latest videos.
Good afternoon, candidates. So, welcome to the group discussion session. So, before we begin the session, let us go through the format of the group discussion. Initially, after the topic is disclosed, you will be given 2 minutes to think about the topic and write down your points. Then it will be followed by the 5 minutes of the group discussion session where every one of you can give their opinion. So the topic for today's discussion is, to what extent can we rely upon the Indian Army for peace restoration? And your time starts now.
Okay, so I would start by contesting the very definition of peace we have in the topic itself. I think the definition of peace and peace restoration is skewed towards the pro-government side. But in reality, citizens have different notion of peace and government has different notion of peace. What happens is that these notions do not always agree. So I don't think we should just take for granted what understanding of peace we have in this discourse.
But what I think is that there cannot be two different definitions of peace. For one for central government and one for the locals, because otherwise the central government cannot function. There has to be one unified concept that all of us agree upon.
Agreed. The workability is an important part, but that doesn't mean government's definition of peace is the most plausible one.
But you know, we can't just doubt the government's definition of peace, because you know, rational people are involved in formulation of the definition at some level. So we can't take it
Before deciding the definition of peace, I think we need to throw some light on the case of Kashmir. It has been more than 50 years, and Kashmir is like India and Pakistan have been fighting over Kashmir for more than 50 years, and peace hasn't been restored.
So peace hasn't been restored over there because there are different warlike situations over there, and hence to protect the people there are different acts also. There is relaxation from other rules and regulations for people in Kashmir.
I would bring back the point to candidate number one's case about Kashmir, because Kashmir has been treated with the same definition of peace that you are talking about government uses, and the whole project of solving Kashmir problem is based upon peace restoration. But look how that turns out in practice. Cases like Kashmir are an example that government's definition is completely flawed and not defensible by any rational people generally.
You must also take into consideration the amount of money that is involved in, you know, employing Indian Army in Kashmir, and the amount of people that die every day. That is a violation of human rights. So I think, you know, we should resort to non-violence to restore peace.
But if you are talking about non-violence, I take it that you are talking about treaties and meetings between two different countries and their diplomats. But I want to bring your attention to the point that when the peace has reached a level when it needs to be restored, there is already disturbance that is caused to the locals and other countrymen also. So there, it cannot be restored by conversations inside office. There has to be some intervention for army.
So your point about treaties and acts is important, because you know, these things show us that the cases where unrest happens is not just a military issue but also a political issue. So what the role of military in these cases is just to reduce the effects of the actual unrest, which is socio-economic and political. However, the actual solution of the problem has to do with diplomats and politicians.
But you know, politics and military don't go hand in hand in every nation of the world. For example, consider the case of Pakistan, where we have, you know, military is not under direct control of government, so we can't rely on treaties which are signed by the government that military will abide to them.
I think in the history also, World War I and World War II have been resolved. Peace has been restored using treaties only. So I think without involving the armies, peace can be restored.
There but are there success have cases of peace being restored by Indian Army also in United Nations. In 2006, there was peace restoration mission in South Lebanon. In 1963 and 1964, Observer Force Commander was appointed by Indian Army. And in Kashmir, there are special provisions that we're talking about, but Indian Army has successfully restored peace before this.
But by using that argument, you're just neglecting the cases of Northeast India and Kashmir, where provisions, as you said, like AFSPA, have involved in gross human rights violation. What, how would you defend those things under the army itself?
That's right, but there are different geographical and political and social reasons also for that. So we cannot see that Indian Army is totally not of use for peace restoration.
I think there are some areas where army has to be used and there are some areas where non-violence can be used.
But
there has to be a threshold decided to, you know, decide whether army should be employed.
But
or
by
not.
Using that, you're just creating a false dichotomy about when we should use army
That's
and when we should not.
Then.
The argument is about whether army can use actually restore peace. Even recently, Amrinder Singh, who's the CM of Punjab, who is an ex-army person as well as a politician, talks about how the role of army has got nothing to do with peace.
So I think just to conclude conclude what all of us have said, I would like to say that there are some cases where peace can be restored by treaties and discussions, but there are some cases where you have to be on your toes and protect your people.
Yeah,
stop.
Agreed.
Subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon to get instant updates for latest videos.